Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP ENCOR, Enterprise Core, exam. In this video, we'll take a look at RSTP's sync process, which allows switch ports to immediately start forwarding without having to spend 30 seconds transitioning like in classic STP. But before we get started, let's try something new. Dark mode. Let me know what you think. I'm going to experiment with this for a few videos, so I'm curious to hear your feedback, both positive and negative. I might change the color scheme a bit, and if it doesn't work out, I'll just revert back to light mode. Okay, let's get started. Here's what we'll cover in this video. First, a very brief review of classic STP convergence, which takes 30 seconds, or even 50 seconds in some situations. Then we'll move on to rapid STP convergence, which is often sub-second, enabling practically immediate convergence. We'll also cover what happens when the sync process fails, for example, when using the RSTP shared link type on a port. To summarize, the RSTP sync process is the main benefit of RSTP over classic STP. It allows ports to immediately move to the forwarding state, instead of relying on classic STP's timer-based process. Classic STP's slow convergence times simply aren't acceptable in modern networks. Let's get started with a quick review of classic STP convergence, so we can then compare it to RSTP. When a switch port is enabled, it becomes an STP-designated port until its appropriate role is determined. So, when we connect switch 1 and switch 2, bringing up their G00 ports, they will both be designated ports. And each port will start in the listening state, unable to forward data frames, but sending BPDUs every 2 seconds. Each switch will declare itself to be the root bridge, until it receives a superior BPDU from another switch. Superior means superior in the STP algorithm, and when it comes to determining the root bridge, that means having the lowest bridge ID. So once these ports come online, each switch sends a BPDU, announcing itself as the root bridge. Switch 1 says switch 1 is the root bridge, and switch 2 says switch 2 is the root bridge. As soon as switch 2 receives switch 1's superior BPDU, switch 2 accepts switch 1 as the root bridge, because switch 1 has a lower bridge ID than switch 2. So switch 2 G00 becomes a root port, and stops sending BPDUs, although switch 1 continues sending them every 2 seconds. Then, after 15 seconds, switch 1 G00 and switch 2 G00 transition to the learning state. They can now learn MAC addresses if frames are received on those ports, but they are still unable to forward frames. Then, after an additional 15 seconds in the learning state, switch 1 and switch 2's ports can transition to the forwarding state. Finally, after a total of 30 seconds in the listening and learning states, they can forward frames. And switch 1, of course, continues sending BPDUs every 2 seconds, because it is the root bridge. So that was a quick review of how STP convergence works, not a very quick process. Now let's see how RSTP speeds up convergence using its sync process. First, just like in STP, when a switch port is enabled, it becomes an RSTP-designated port until its appropriate role is determined. So let's connect these two switches together. Note that each port will start in the discarding state, which includes the functions of both the STP blocking and listening states. As before, each switch will declare itself to be the root bridge until it receives a superior BPDU from another switch. So just like before, each switch sends BPDUs claiming that it is the root bridge. But here's a major difference. The proposal bit is set in these BPDUs. This is how an RSTP switch attempts to initiate the sync process. Basically, the proposal bit indicates that the switch is proposing itself as the designated bridge for the segment. You might not be familiar with the term designated bridge. It's not used very often. The designated bridge is the switch that has the designated port for the link, for the segment. As you probably know by now, in an STP or RSTP LAN, every segment must have exactly one designated port. Well, the switch that has a segment's designated port is that segment's designated bridge. The root bridge is the designated bridge for every segment it is connected to. So in our case, switch 1 and switch 2 both think they are the root bridge, and both are therefore proposing themselves as the designated bridge for this link between them. In RSTP, a designated port in the discarding or learning state always sets the proposal bit on BPDUs it sends to attempt to initiate the sync process. Upon receiving switch 1 superior proposal BPDU, switch 2 accepts switch 1 as the root bridge. Switch 1, on the other hand, ignores switch 2's proposal. It is inferior to switch 1's own proposal. So switch 2 G00 becomes a root port, and the next step is key. Switch 2 responds with an agreement BPDU, that is, a BPDU with the agreement bit set. By the way, we'll examine RSTP BPDUs using Wireshark in the next lab video. We'll look at the proposal and agreement bits then. Root ports normally don't send BPDUs. Only designated ports do. But this is an exception. So thanks to this proposal agreement exchange, switch 2 G00 immediately transitions to the forwarding state. And switch 1 G00 does the same after receiving switch 2's agreement BPDU. The RSTP sync process is complete. All of this should occur in less than a second, quite an improvement over STP's 30-second process. The proposal agreement exchange is the key mechanism of the RSTP sync process. Let's examine how it looks in debug output on the two switches, starting with switch 1. So first on switch 1, we can see that G00 is initialized and becomes a designated port. It transmits a few proposals, and then receives an agreement. That's the output on switch 1. Now let's see switch 2. Like switch 1, switch 2 initialized G00 and made it a designated port. It then transmitted a proposal on G00, but soon after received a superior BPDU from switch 1, and made G00 its root port. With that, switch 2 G00 is synced, and transmits an agreement BPDU to switch 1. That was a very simple example. Two switches connected by a single link. However, there's one more key element of the sync process that we haven't covered. I've added switch 3 to the topology, so let's see how it works now. Switch 1 has the lowest bridge ID, so when it sends a proposal BPDU to switch 2, switch 2 accepts it as superior. Now here's the key point. Switch 2 then moves all downstream non-edge ports to the discarding state. Downstream means non-edge ports that lead away from the root bridge. This is important for ensuring that no loops occur during the sync process. In this case, switch 2 moves G01 to the discarding state if necessary. If it's already in the discarding state, there's no need to change that state, of course. But if it was forwarding, it would move to discarding. However, note that edge ports, like these two connected to PCs, ports that have portfast enabled, aren't disabled. They don't pose a risk of causing loops, so they can remain forwarding. Switch 2 then sends an agreement to switch 1, accepting switch 1's proposal. And then switch 1 G00 and switch 2 G00 can immediately transition to the forwarding state. So the switch 1 switch 2 link is synchronized. What about the switch 2 switch 3 link? Switch 2 and switch 3 must sync as well. So switch 2 sends a proposal BPDU to switch 3, and switch 3 accepts it as superior. Switch 3 sends an agreement BPDU to switch 2 to accept its proposal. Then finally, switch 2 G01 and switch 3 G00 immediately transition to the forwarding state. The link between switch 2 and switch 3 is now synced. So that's a high-level look at how the sync process works. There's still a lot of room to get into the weeds, and we will cover some more details and scenarios in the lab video. But that's enough for now. Before finishing up, let's look at a couple of scenarios where the RSTP sync process fails, and a switch's ports aren't able to immediately transition to the forwarding state. First, the RSTP sync process only works on ports with the point-to-point link type. Ports using the shared link type cannot take advantage of RSTP's sync process. And second, the connected switches must both be using RSTP. The sync mechanism is a part of RSTP, so a switch running classic STP can't sync. The port on the RSTP-enabled switch will operate like a classic STP port instead. In such cases, ports must spend 30 seconds transitioning through discarding and learning before forwarding. So here's a sample network. We'll look at it from Switch 1's perspective. G00 is connected to Switch 2 and Switch 3 via a hub, and uses the shared link type. G01 is connected directly to Switch 4, using the point-to-point link type. And G02 is connected directly to Switch 5 using the point-to-point link type, but Switch 5 is running classic STP. So which of these ports will be able to sync and immediately transition to forwarding, and which will take 30 seconds? G01 will be able to sync with Switch 4. The link type is point-to-point, and both switches run RSTP. However, G00 and G02 won't be able to sync with their neighbors. G00's link type is shared, and G02 connects to a switch running classic STP. So they will spend 15 seconds in discarding, 15 seconds in learning, and then finally transition to forwarding. In a modern LAN where all switches run RSTP, these situations shouldn't occur, but just be aware that the sync process doesn't work in all scenarios. Here's what we covered in this video. First, we reviewed classic STP convergence. Designated and root ports spend 15 seconds in listening and 15 seconds in learning before transitioning to the forwarding state, taking a total of 30 seconds. We then covered rapid STP convergence using the sync process. Designated ports in the discarding or learning state set the proposal bit in BPDUs they send. The purpose is to propose itself as the designated bridge for the segment, in an attempt to start the sync process. If the neighbor accepts the proposal as superior, it first transitions all non-edge downstream ports to the discarding state to avoid causing any layer 2 loops. It then responds to the proposal by sending a BPDU with the agreement bit set, and the two switches immediately transition their connected ports to the forwarding state. The link is now synced, and this process usually takes less than a second, much faster than classic STP's timer-based system. This sync process then continues until all ports in the LAN are synced. We saw an example with three switches in this video, and in the next lab video, we'll see another with more switches. We also covered two situations in which the RSTP sync process fails. Ports that use the shared link type cannot sync, and neither can ports connected to a switch running classic STP. In both cases, the port will spend 15 seconds in discarding and 15 seconds in learning before transitioning to the forwarding state. So it will take 30 seconds, just like in classic STP. Okay, now let's do a quick quiz to test your understanding. Here's question 1. Which of the following ports sets the proposal bit in BPDUs it sends? Select 2. Pause the video now to think about your answers. Okay, the answers are A, a designated port in the discarding state, and E, a designated port in the learning state. First of all, only designated ports send proposal BPDUs, so we can rule out B and F. C is incorrect because a designated port that has already reached the forwarding state has no need to initiate the sync process, so it doesn't set the proposal bit. And D is incorrect because the listening state doesn't exist in rapid STP. If a port is in the listening state, it means the switch is running classic STP. Okay, let's move on to question 2. Examine the network below. Which of Switch 1's ports can immediately transition to forwarding? Select all that apply. Pause the video now to think about your answers. Okay, the answers are G00, G01, and G04. G00 and G04 are edge ports connected to end hosts, so they can use portfast to immediately transition to the forwarding state. And G01 is a point-to-point link connected to another switch, so it can use the RSTP sync process to immediately transition to forwarding. G02 is connected to a hub, and therefore should use the RSTP shared link type. It won't be able to take advantage of the sync process. And G03, although a point-to-point link with another switch, connects to switch 5, which runs classic STP. Therefore, switch 1G03 has to function like a classic STP port, taking 30 seconds to transition to the forwarding state. Okay, that's all for the quiz and this video. I hope it was helpful. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Velva Jacob, George, Nasir Chowdhury, Gustavo Macedo, Marcel Lord, Pavel M., Drago Cernea, Zakib Shah, Mira Salman, Vitaus194, Chance Carter 56, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillaume, Fristas1207, Gabriel Braga, Hector Hernandez, Roji Kuriakos, Arpad Conives, 5 Feet, Owad Daniel Brown, Jose Alvarez, Hussein Yavuz, Samuel Tavares, Kevin Hayes, Roger Bratseth, Brian Grant, Georgi Gemejev, Cats for Life, Adelson Pereira, Farad69, Joyce Njoroge, Lucian Stoichatoyu, Madmark50484, Alexandru Stratan, Hiago Bicalho, DMJ2, Kurt Nell, Omid Farakesh, Steve Cox, Jasper Yim, Wilmer Romero, Pedro Hartman, TrickyMickey123456, Ivano Capuano, Enigma G, Jefferson Steelflex, Burl Campbell, Abhishek Sahu, Toxic Sinan Sarisenar, Gio Daniel Andrade, Mike Crumby, Jairo Francisco, Dragos George, Philip Jovanovich, Random User 7547, Wagner Botelho, Mateusz Wzaszynski, Ruben Hernandez, Electro Jedi, Girish, Trevor Goldman, Gavin Paul Tech, Sunny Idigu, Jeffrey C., Stephen White, Shami Ashmi, Haven Edificare, dot 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 dot, Dragon J, Fio Fio Hein, Omkar Rao Rane, and Dimitro Lees. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So, if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching.